absolutely alive and risen, and may that thought spark joy in us today, and may we lift our voices in song. We're going to do that in a second, but as we get going, I just want to read a call to worship just to set the tone for the day in our minds and souls and hearts as we endeavor to worship the risen Christ today. Does that sound good? Does this sound good? All right, that's slightly better than the 8 o'clock service, so I expect a lot from you guys. You have a little bit of extra time to sleep, so just get ready for it. Here we go. Let no one fear death. The death of our Savior has set us free. He is destroyed by enduring it. He destroyed hell. Thank you.
Thank you.
celebration. Father, thank you for the gift of this day, the gift of what Easter is, what Easter means. The Son of God, the King of the cosmos, enters into this mess to write it, to make it to be beautiful. We thank you that we are here today, gathered together to worship. What a privilege. What a privilege to be with brothers and sisters. What a privilege to open up your scripture and to gaze upon Jesus Christ. Father, we don't take it for granted that here we are worshiping you today. Would you lovingly impress who you are on our hearts this morning? Would they burn in your life for you? Would they ache to see you clearly? Father, would you give me clarity of mind and strength and ability to communicate clearly to my brothers and sisters? I admit I'm excited this Easter Sunday, but I'm nervous in a sense that who is sufficient for these things? To explain that history was cracked open and a whole new creation is being born because of the work of Jesus Christ. To speak about resurrection. Lord, would you help me? And are you with me? And are you here with us today? Would you minister to us that we might praise you all? We love you. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Now, welcome all. You may be seated. It is good to have you here today. My name is Keith. I'm one of the pastors. Thank you for joining us today. Those in the family room upstairs with all those little kiddos running around, we pray this finds you well. Glad to have you. And all of you joining us online, thank you so much for being with us today on this special Easter Sunday. Now, today we have the joy of walking the road home. That's the title of this Easter Sunday message, The Road Home. And on this road home, we enter into a mysterious, a marvelous, and a meaningful Easter story. Now, maybe you know the story. Maybe you don't know the story. Or maybe you've heard about it, but you didn't realize it actually took place on Easter Sunday. Either way, my prayer is that our eyes would be opened and that our heart would be warmed to the truth of the good news that we see here on this road home. And there's a line in here, this incredible line where it says, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he opened up the scriptures to us?" And I hope it's okay for me to say, but that's the kind of preacher I would like to be this morning, one who, as we open up the scriptures, according to 2020 events.
We're in the Gospel of Luke, the third one in, and towards the end of that book, chapter 24. So, let's go ahead and get into Luke chapter 24, starting at verse 13. That very day, two of them were going through a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking to them about all these things that had happened. The road home. They are on the road home. It's Sunday. And Jerusalem is out there back, fading into the distance as two apprentices, two disciples of Jesus, are walking home. They're headed to Emmaus, a village some 7 miles outside of Jerusalem. And it's that very day, it's that same day where some of their friends, some of the women of their group, came to them and said, "The tomb is empty. He's risen. It's Easter Sunday." But for these two, they're looking at a whole different reality. They are walking home from a funeral. That's what's going on. They're walking home from a funeral. Their friend, their teacher, the hope of their salvation was arrested, was tortured, was nailed to a cross, died a brutal, shameful death, and was buried behind a stone. So they're walking home after a funeral, walking home with broken hearts, walking home with shattered hopes, disillusioned, and devastated. As they walk, they're talking over what in the world just happened. They're walking home a traumatized people. In short order, their whole world had changed, had been upended. As they walk with heavy hearts and heavy feet, they are trying to process what just happened. How in the world could it come to this? How is it that the one who rode into Jerusalem and was cheered on as a king, the one who raised the dead to life, I mean, they had just seen Lazarus eat food as per usual the last week after he had been in the grave? How is it the one who had talked so magnificently, so radiantly, who had done so many miracles, was murdered in common criminal persona non grata? So many hopes utterly shattered, violently broken. That is what happened. The hope was killed and buried behind a stone. That is what happened. All now was uncertain. Their life had taken on a whole new shape. That is what happened. Things have changed. Their life won't be the same. That is what happened. Now here they are. They're here in this present moment, walking this road. They are traumatized people living in the wake of a new world. They are walking a hard road home, grieving and wondering, where is God in all of this? Why is His absence so obvious? But this isn't all. This isn't all that's going on. Because they're not alone as they walk. Look at the verse 15. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus Himself drew near and He went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing Him. And He said to them, "What is this conversation that you're holding with each other here?" And they stood still, looking sad. A short one. Segment with meaning, into where their hearts are. They stood still and paralyzed, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" See, Jesus shows up. He does. He shows up. But as a stranger, He's not obvious to them. Their eyes somehow are kept from seeing Him. Jesus incognito, Savior, under its cover, And man, I have questions here. I don't understand. Like, well, what is it? Did he look completely different? Like, did his voice sound different? Did he have a hoodie pulled up tight? I mean, were their eyes so covered and glassy with tears that they couldn't see him? Sounds like something more supernatural is happening here, but I don't know. But I do know this. I know it is often true that Jesus is not often recognized in our lives when he's right there in the middle of it with us. And I do know that our Savior is often experienced as a stranger. My life many times. Now, Jesus asked him a question. And the story takes this funny, literally ironic turn here. What are you talking about? What are you talking about here? Says this stranger to Jesus. Now, one of them, named Cleopas, he opens up and he says, Are you the only one? Like, where have you been? Under a rock, hiding in a cave? So Jesus literally just said, yeah, that's what's been going on. Everybody knows the media is in full swing. Jesus has been sending hashtags, our hashtagging tweets, our Twittering posts, our posting rumors, our rumbling, pundits are opining. Where have you been? And the delicious irony is that Jesus is the only one who really knows what in the world and in heaven has been going on. He's not the blind one. His eyes are open. But they're the blind one. They can't see. But Jesus keeps it going. He asks them another question. Verse 19. And he said to them, what things? And they said to him, well, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, the man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers, they delivered him up to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who would bring this to them. They had hoped he was the long-promised hero, Messiah, the one who would bring peace, shalom, who would lead together all that is ripped apart. He continued, yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things have happened. And you can almost hear confusion in his voice. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early this morning. And when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the same time as the woman said, but for him they did not see. And isn't this great? Jesus, who is just seen as the cosmic king, the one who is vindicated because of his beating of death, there he is, the cosmic king playing dumb. And his humility to meet his people. He says, oh yeah, what thing? Do you tell? He's up to something. He's trying to get into their hearts and their minds. And then they lay it all out. The life and ministry of Jesus of Nazareth, the one that they thought was going to be the Messiah, God's hero, who would make everything right. He'd step onto the scene and splash, done marvelous works and miracles, captivated people's imagination, taught in ways that no one had ever taught. But then, well, it's like he's just hated by the religious leaders and he's put to death on trumped up charges. That was 3 days ago. Today is the report of an empty tomb. They hadn't seen Jesus. It was too much. So they had left the volatile and dangerous city to walk this long, sad road home. Well, Jesus isn't done doing his work, so he responds. Verse 25. And he said to them, foolish one, slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ could suffer these things and enter into his glory. And beginning with Moses and the prophets, it's the first book of the Bible, and then all the ensuing books of the Old Testament, what we call the Old Testament. So beginning with the beginning there in the Scriptures, he interpreted to them in all the Scriptures the things concerning himself. This is amazing. The unrecognized Jesus calls them out for not believing what the Scriptures said. This is the plan all along. All of what we call the Old Testament is pointed towards a Messiah, a hero, one who would enter into suffering to become the victor, one who would enter into agony to enter into his glory, one who would be wounded in his winning over evil, one who would stomp the head of the dragon, stomp the head of the serpent, but his heel would be wounded in that act of triumph. You know, instead of Jesus going, hey, I'm here and gathering them and doing something supernatural, so to speak, that would have been a spectacle in their eyes, he does the most unusual thing, at least to us in the modern world. He says, don't forget your Scriptures. All along, they have pointed to this reality, to the coming of the cross, to the necessity of overcoming death and being born again. From page one on, the Scriptures are coherent. They're accurate. It is a unified story. The Bible is the God-breathed, humanity-tend, story-shaped library that leads to encountering Jesus, and he wants them to encounter him and the reality of who he is through God's Word. He opens up the Scriptures. He shows me the authority of the Scriptures, and it makes me wonder how much of our time has been wasted or ill-used imbibing the words of the pundits instead of the prophets, listening more to gossip columns than the gospel, letting the world and its bad news form us instead of letting the good news of the Scriptures conform us to them. So that's where they are, right? They're on the road home. Jesus is showing them who he is and what has to be done through the Scriptures. Now, where's all this headed? Where's this going? Well, what he said must have been captivating enough to them, even though he called them foolish, because they invited him for dinner. On to verse 28. So they drew near the village to which they were going, Emmaus, and he acted as if he were going to sleep. But they urged him strongly, saying, stay with us, for it's toward evening, and the day is now far spent. So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took the bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. If you thought the story was weird up until this point, hold on, because it's about to get bizarre. He took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, he gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked with us on the road, while he opened the Scriptures to us? And Jesus said, well, it's been nice traveling with you guys. Plays like he's going to keep walking on. And it's not a right thing. He was up. It's late. And then here's the big reveal. At this meal they have together, this twist of the story for these traumatized pilgrims, the pivot of their story. Jesus stays and he eats with them. And he takes the bread and prays. Now, suddenly Jesus is the host instead of them. And he does what he's done 100 times with his apprentices, with his friends. He takes the bread and bless it, give thanks for it, break it, and distribute it to them. And that's what he does. And it's in that moment, like he would have done on the Passover night, take that bread, break it, distribute it. It's in that moment of the broken bread, that is a symbol of his broken body, what he had to do, that the blinders come off, the scales fall off their eyes, that the blind can see. It's because Jesus for who he was. They realize, of course, this is why our hearts were busy and on fire on the road when he opened up the scriptures. He's alive. The story all along, all of its lines and trajectories land in him. This makes sense of the world. This makes sense of the scriptures. This makes sense of the deepest desires of my heart, this happily ever after going through the tellus road we've walked. Well, this was physical and spiritual adrenaline pumping. They don't waste any time. They get up and hit the road. Verse 33. And they rose that same hour, in that moment. Immediately, they rose and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, "The Lord is risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." That's Peter, and by the way, if you wonder why we say he's risen indeed, it's because we are echoing a chorus of our family, our first family that has been sung for thousands and thousands of years. He's risen indeed. Well, then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. As they were talking about the things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace." Their heartbroken, one-way trip has been transformed into a joyous round trip. Back to where the hurt happened. The heavy leaden feet now have wings. Their hearts are racing as they race back to Jerusalem. Their trauma has been transformed into joy and mission and purpose. Hope has been headed back to where they experienced the hurt. And they make a 7-mile journey, what I imagine was probably record time. They find their friends and they drop the Easter news. And so he's risen, and they say, "Yeah, he's risen indeed, we know. Peter told us." And they're together as a reunited group of people. They profess that he is risen. And in their presence, as they profess faith in him and what he's done, he appears to them. There he is. And as he appears, he greets them with these words, "Peace to you. Shalom, Erene. Peace to you. May all things be made right with you. May all that is frayed be woven together. May all that is out of stock and out of joint be put back in. May it be for flourishing for you." That's what Jesus says. He brings peace to the wounded heart. He brings peace to the restless and the weary and those fatigued in soul. And he brings the lonely and the outcast who have been out walking on that road, shedding tears, back into community to be with brothers and sisters, to confess the truth and experience the joy of being in the presence of their God. He reestablishes and reunites community. There you have it. There you have it. What has happened? Part one, part two, we are here now in the middle. And part three, where is this heading? My friends, I pray you see that this Easter, this very day, right now, that we are on a similar road home. And in fact, you could take our stories and map it over the story we just heard, and they would overlay perfectly. So let me make two connections at two levels here. First, this year and the way forward to post-pandemic life. 2020 was brutal. It was painful. It was incredibly traumatic. It changed things, didn't it? Did it change anything for any of you? I know it changed things for me. It changed things for this church family. We've had people move. We've had jobs ripped away, dried up. We've had friendships devastated, families torn apart because of verbal violence, because of the polarization that our culture is pumping out into our feed. We've lost loved ones physically and relationally. The world has a different shape. Some of our comfort and understanding of safety has been ripped away. We have undergone paradigm earthquakes. Disillusionment is set in. Grief, anxiety, and depression have accelerated. It is hard to find time with the counselor or therapist. They are so backlogged. Life has proved to be different than we thought. Well, like these two apprentices of Jesus walking sorrow for 7 miles home, we have been through trauma at a corporate level. We are walking home to what is called a new normal, to a post-traumatic new way of being. What does peace look like beside of what we've experienced? And like those two on the road, the resurrected Jesus has come alongside us in our sorrow. He is present with us on this hard road home. He has been present with us as we turn left and right and into the valley of 2020. But if we're honest, we have often not recognized His presence. We have not recognized His presence in His Word, through the Scriptures, by the power of His Spirit speaking to us and ministering to us. We have often not recognized His presence in His church, in His people. We have often not recognized His presence in that phone call, or that text, or that letter you received, or that so-called random running into somebody at the grocery store who you haven't seen in 2 years and gave you a word of encouragement. And we have often not seen God's use of suffering to bring about restoration, to make us somehow healthier and more whole people. So here we are in the middle on the road to restoration, not seen. As followers of this risen Jesus, we need to know He is with us. And where is it going? What's part 3 of the story? Where is it heading? What does the future look like for us as a church family, for us as individuals, as we move into the rest of 2021 and next year? Well, I don't know. But I do know this. It is heading to a greater realization of who Jesus is. It's heading into eating with Jesus, into greater communion with Jesus. He has revealed things in our hearts as the tide pulled back this past year, and we got to see all the sharp rocks and coral that are underneath our own soul. He's healing us, working on us, calling us to Him. And He's also doing this. He's heading us to a renewed vitality, a renewed sense of community, taking those who are lonely and sorrowful out in that world alone, on that road of hardship, bringing them back into community with brothers and sisters that they might fellowship with each other and proclaim and profess the truth and experience the presence of their Savior. Now, this is one level of what happened where we are now and where we are headed. Look at this past year. But zoom out. Let's go meta here. Let's go 30,000 feet. Go to cosmic level. Go to the level of our existence, the level of our being human. What's happened? So much trauma. So much sin. So much brokenness and devastation and ruin. We have all sinned against God, have divorced ourselves from His love, thought we knew better, disavowed His wisdom, and went our way, only to send relational shrapnel 360 degrees. We have all contributed to the jagged edges of life. We have all been hurt. We have all hurt people. Hurt people, hurt people. We have all been racked and wrecked by shattered hopes. And we've all had our heroes, our so-called messiahs and saviors, let us down. We all need healing and redemption, and we all have participated in crucifying Christ. And now we are here, in the middle, walking a broken road to some place called home, dealing with the consequences of sin and loss and death, all experiencing our various forms of confusion, trying to make the best of all the pieces, asking God, is He unaware? Lord, do you see what's going on? Where are you? Have you crawled under a rock? Are you hiding in a cave? Do you read my news feed? Can you read my heart? And here on this road and fearful journey, Jesus often goes unrecognized. He has come to this earth to face our sorrows and to redeem them. And his scriptures point to them over and over and over again. And the most brilliant interweave of literature the human being has ever seen. And we disavow it, refute it, deny it, reject it, or untrust it. Friends, the presence of the resurrected Jesus is here with us. Now, as we speak here in this very moment we are in. And so I ask you, might it be that Jesus has been present with you on your road of suffering and he has not been recognized? Is it possible that throughout your journey and in the times of suffering that he was there but simply unrecognized? Might we have accused him of being a loose and absent? God, you're the only one who doesn't care about this. Now, where are we heading? Where is all this going? Well, the good news is that we are not just heading to any old home, not just some new normal, but to eat with Jesus, to be with him, the death conqueror, the one who entered into the grave and kicked out the back and turned the casket into a road home. The king of all creation, the very source of all the beauty in the world that you crave in some twisted form, he is the pure source of it all, and we get to be drawn into greater communion with him. And trusting him, eating with him, communing with him, leads us into flourishing. The good life, which we all crave, and all the commercials are trying to set up. He leads us into a life of rich union with him and rich community with each other. And in that community, we experience his presence. And now with purpose, we go and draw others into the business. Friends, someday we will eat to feast with the resurrected Jesus and the people of God in the new creation when he has wiped away every tear. See, the road home, the road to our true home is through the cross of Jesus and runs straight into the tomb, right back out and into a transformed life. It is a life of glory born of agony, of flourishing, born through suffering, victory that came through struggle. The resurrection of Jesus has opened the road home. Easter is the day that God opened the road home to be back with him, to peace, to flourishing, to union with him and each other, to put our hearts back in the socket. He died for the forgiveness of our sins, rose from the dead to give us the Spirit to unite us to himself. Also, the resurrection of Jesus means he walked this road with us. Jesus knows our suffering. He entered into the mess. He has felt the pain of the road beneath his feet. He knows, guys. He knows. And he is with us as we walk this road, whatever's ahead. We're not alone. And third here, the resurrection of Jesus means that there is no earthly sorrow that heaven cannot heal. What news? There's nothing he cannot redeem and U-turn into something incredible. And I love this phrase of some Thomas More, a theologian from a long time ago. And here's the context in which he said it. He said, here, bring your wounded heart. Here, tell your anguish. Earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. Heaven has broken into this earth through the resurrection, the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Easter is the day that says in a golden, bright, hallelujah chorus, there is no trauma that he cannot save us from. There is no despair that he cannot reroute and redeem. There is no confusion that he cannot bring clarity to. There is no stream of tears, no matter how wide, and how hard they are pouring, and he cannot wipe away with his nail-scarred hand. There is no road so broken that he cannot turn you right back to Jerusalem to run
with hope in your heart, to
tell the good news to the very epicenter of hurt. There is no for my friends here today, bless them. And I say to those right now, those who do not know you, in fact, let me speak to them while our heads and hearts bowed and we're praying. If you do not know this Jesus, if you came in here not knowing him, never trusting in him, but something has moved, a stone has shifted in your chest, and your heart now feels like flesh, if you are going to confess him as your Savior, would you even look up here in this moment and let's connect eyes as a symbol of God's healing? Would they taste of your goodness all the days of their life? For today is the day of salvation. Heavenly Father, we love you. Lord Jesus, we love you. May you be glorified. Amen. Shall we sing? Sing.
because of his life.
We'd love to spend some time praying with you right out these doors here to the right. There'll be some people there, a little prayer station. Please don't be bashful. Join us. We'd love to pray with you. And if you looked up and connected during that earlier prayer, God has done something in your heart, and you want to call to Jesus as Savior, and you need someone to pray with, talk with, I would love to do that with you. I'll be out there as well. Please, please come connect with us. A few other things before you leave. In front of you in the pews, there's these connection cards. These are there. There's a QR code on there. You can scan with your phone. It'll take you right to a way to connect with us online so we know how to pray for you, partner with you with whatever's going on in your journey. There's also what's called a connection point meeting, which is coming up here in a few weeks, which is after our second service on Sundays. We meet out in the gathering place. Visitors come. They get to hear us talk about the church. We get to meet you guys. So go ahead and sign up for that. It's on our website as well. Now, let's see. On your way out, I want to let you know that Infant Scott and Tea is out in the gathering place. So offering free, awesome Infant Scott Tea. So go and visit some of our baristas. There's also the photo booth out there, so you can take some pictures with your family. All that said, what a joy. What a joy and privilege to worship with you this morning. So let me give you one last shot at it. You ready? He is risen. Go in his grace and peace. May his face shine upon you. God bless you all. As you leave, feel free to head out.